Next up, we've got Anna Andrianova talking about DAOs. DAOs have had a mixed rap, you know, even some of us have recovered finally from the post-traumatic stress disorder of the DAO. But apparently this is the year of the DAO, so we're looking forward to hearing about models of open collaboration from a classroom.
Good morning. Thanks for being here. So, the segue from the previous panel is just wanted to share the insights that we are through to our on our protocol of last year. We think of that becoming again more and more relevant for a number of reasons, which I'll get into right now, but I think what's interesting is to point out that the community tends to focus so much on innovation that we really forget to look back in history and see what has been, how the structures that we need to become innovative actually existed before, and how this can be used for the experiments that are happening right now. There's nothing new and I just wanted to spend the next 10 minutes sharing with you the insights of how dialogue structures have been discovered through our research and the insights that are helpful for the governance and design. Or DAOs are a little bit actually the difference and have practical significance. So, if you go through the timeline of how people used to organize themselves in traditional groups, this goes back in 20 centuries. We can trace back DAOs to the original prototype, which is a community group, evolving into a guild, evolving into mutual, into a credit union, into cooperative banking, into investment banking, and then back into DAO. What technology software enables is a remote coordination. Or what's important to understand is that the problem is not the new and the way it's been solved over the last, let's say, 6-7 centuries. That actually represents a really interesting guide to what we can be using right now in our development. A few examples that may be helpful. Large number of organizations existed in major global markets for decades. That's something that, again, a lot of people aren't necessarily aware of. But if you look at the size of number of organizations that have come on commercial goals, very impressive. Where Zelen was considering up. Turnover from 32, or basic electric, $2 billion, turnover, $4 billion, natural assets, producing $1 billion, $210 billion assets for companies in the Japan, and a suddenly a trillion for Germans in the U.S. These groups have one thing in common. They are owned by the members. They want to contribute to the government, the governance, to the balance sheets. Now, if we look at how civil publicity is solved, pre-industrialization, we see one common trend. which is in the most basic anti-sabotage channels, which is actually informal studies between Africa. They are regulated, they don't require, you know, a legal entity. They actually have a separate status in law, insofar as they do not need to be to have a legal entity or be regulated, even if they. So for all intents and purposes, they have to have the DAO-like primitives. If you look at how they're organized, it's quite illuminating. So let's see a little bit. So an average channel typically has 20-25 members. The principles are very, very simple. Same game, mutual accountability, and very clear shared goals. Right? And simple governance structures. Right? So, nothing complicated. And this is what has worked for 6 or 7 centuries in Africa. There's a massive amount of academic research on the topic. And we have a database which is available in our wiki on this subject. But what is really interesting is how sustainable the development structures could themselves be. Right? So we have, if you look at Kenya, just with the use case, they're contributing in terms of the value locked to almost half of the country's GDP. There's a large number of organizations that vary in size. Most importantly, channels that are successful, that have clear goals, mutual accountability, right, and simple governance structure, which is typically under simple majority or delegated governance, they never would grow in size to all go to effectively manage. So the community banks or mutuals. Yeah. So examples of that. Because of their self-employed status, after certain size, as I mentioned, they typically complete non-regulated, so it's better after a while, which then becomes into, yeah, for example, 25,000 member institution with several million assets and annual turnover. So, but we've seen DAOs start, and people knew. Why does it happen? If we look at the use case of channels, the major reasons of collapse is very simple. People don't achieve their goals, right? And they don't get the support to achieve their goals. Similar examples are growth funds in Poland and entrepreneurial networks in Europe, specifically Italy and West Switzerland. So, effectively, even when they have separate goals, so long as the clarity of their objective is there, the skin and the gimmick, and mutual accountability. So unless people get a result within the basic expectations, these structures have proven to be resilient, they're resistant for, in some cases, centuries, in some cases, for decades. They already exchange it from that value, right? And they have exactly the same principles, exactly the same patterns that they have worked in the original DAO and the DAO style on South Africa complex. So, to summarize, we see right now, obviously, people of DAO the DAO founders of a whole bunch of DAO experiments in governance, which, to my mind, are accessible complex. What's been proven to work essentially is a simple supermajority innovative person. What's more important is that they're actually setting out the goals of the DAO and ensuring that resolution is coming in on transparency. So those two considerations actually was the what historically was suggested as a determined success on the majority of the DAO or any other organization. Complexity of governance approaches is actually historically specifically a negative on the DAO. The most successful experiments are groups that have grown to membership of 2,000 members. That's what we look at China and Kenya, the most important The main conclusion is while DAOs present a very attractive potential for solution to having a very close set of goals, still being a participant, economic reward in remaining in DAO. Is the major factor for the DAO surviving and doing that. The governance has to be very, very simple initially, and it can also stay for time. Right now, the focus is more on concrete governance experiments versus shadows and policy. And I think that's something that has to be considered for the DAO's. Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you.